Beginning through the slide of a company overview. So Makemake Fine Chemicals was founded in 2007 and we were part of the Makemake Organics Limited. And post demerger, we will be listed as a separate entity. And this business is going to be completed by mid of July. The Makemake Fine Chemicals Limited is spread over 65 hectares land in the HPCPR region in western part of India. It is also known as the chemical hub of India, where our customers and our raw material suppliers are within the close proximity. We also have more than 700 plus employees, where we have a combination of experience and the young people. We have also financial advisors, technocrats, and a strong team of advisors guiding us for the next phase of growth. In Makemake Fine Chem Limited, currently last 14 years, we have expanded our chloroalkali capacity to reach at 350,000 tons per annum and derivatives capacity of 110,000 tons per annum, including hydrogen peroxide and the chloromethane. And last 4 years, we have achieved 21% growth. Along with EBITDA in CAGR, we have grown 16%. And down the line, the company has targeted to achieve financial year 2024, achieve 2000 crore turnover, along with a value addition product like epichlorohydrin and CPVC. So our core area of operation is chloroalkali and value added derivatives. We have a unique strategic positioning and a strong edge in our area of operations, and we will discuss those in detail.
Sure. So let me take you through the following slides. So in that, the most important benefit for the MFL is the strategic location of the facility. So how it is beneficial? So first, it is in the Gujarat, where there is the highest second number of seaports. So it is very close to the Hazira, Mundra, and Pipavav. So that helps us in terms of serving the international and the domestic clients. And in terms of industrial infrastructure, if you see, as it is in the PCPR region, there are many chemical companies over there. So the basic raw material required, and also the clients whom we are going to serve in that region. Plus, tomorrow, as we are in the expansion mode, as we do, we do not as such require in clearance. I mean, it is an easy process. Plus, in terms of surface connectivity, if you can see, by rail, by road, by water, we have a good connection. And in that way, we can easily serve the whole part of the country. And also, as I said earlier, in proximity to the raw material, that is salt and coal, and also in terms of the customers, and also in terms of, because that whole region is based on the petrochemical and the chemical region. So it's also good for sourcing the employees and the laborers. Now let me take you to the competitive strengths of the company. I mean, it is a well invested infrastructure. When we say well invested is when in 2007, the management of the company had a long-term vision to buy such a big land and do such a long expansion. So that long-term vision that we had and being in that strategic location, plus the manufacturing facility, it's a fully integrated manufacturing facility. So ultimately that helps us to further do a forward integration in the our derivatives products, like we have done in the chloromethanes, hydrogen peroxide, and down the line we are going to do in the CPVC and the epichlorohydrin. Plus, second is the focus on the efficiency. Like though we are into the chloralkali and now we are into the chloromethanes and the hydrogen peroxide, but the company is very well focused on the efficiency and in terms of the cost of operations. So that can be achieved because of the backward and the forward integration that we have. And that is because of the design of the plant, which is done in such a way that is, there is a smooth flow of the raw materials and also the forward integrated raw materials required for the chloromethanes and the hydrogen peroxide. It's a well-established plant. We are serving to our clients for more than 12 years. So, and we have a very good relationship with our distributors and all the customers because of the timely and the quality product that we provide to them. We have, as Molly just said, that we are getting into the ECH and also the CPVC. So we are ultimate customers are diversified now, so we are not dependent on any particular industry. So that actually helps us, and also few of our raw materials are actually an essential requirement. So all this put together is guided by a technically qualified leadership team, the promoters, and also each department have a senior level person who has a good experience, plus there is a team of young and experienced people. So all put together, we are moving ahead for the next leap of growth that is supposed to come. This is a chart which will give a brief about the fully integrated complex. So what we are trying to draw over here is that if you see the main core strength of the company is the caustic chloroalkaline, that is the caustic soda and caustic potash. So the co-products which are coming out of it, that is the chlorine, hydrogen, HCl, are basically used in the value-added derivative products that we are getting into. Like already it is using the chloromethanes, hydrogen peroxide, and is going to be using ECH also and CPVC. So this fully integrated complex, both backward and forward, makes us more stronger in terms of efficiency. These are the levers of future growth. Here, if we can see, we are currently in the four products which are already commissioned. One is caustic soda, hydrogen peroxide, chloromethane, and caustic potash. But now we are moving way forward to get into other two products, that is the epichlorohydrin and CPVCH. CPVC. In epichlorohydrin, again, in India, there is no one who manufactures the ECH. We will be the first one who will be setting up this facility. First one to set up the facility, plus also on the 100% renewable resources. So we are again moving one step forward in terms of reducing the carbon footprint and getting into that. Again, the demand for the ECH in India right now is around 62,000 tons per annum. And it is expected to grow by around 10% CAGR over a period of next 5 to 7 years. So there is a huge scope. So we are getting into that. Plus, as I discussed in the earlier slide, the raw material required for that, part of it is coming from our main core strength, the chloralkali. So basically that will enhance our efficiency much better. Same way, if we go for CPVC, like you all know, CPVC resin is basically raw material for the majority of the pipes which are now used in almost chemical companies or even all the kind of construction. So there is a huge demand for that category also. And currently, the demand for CPVC resin in India is around 123 tons per annum for FY21, again, which is expected to grow by 13% CAGR. And as on today, once we commission this plant, which should happen in Q2 FY23, we'll be the largest manufacturer of CPVC resin. So all in all, CapEx report, and also to support ECH and CPVC, we are expanding our capacity in the caustic soda. So we had the capacity of 294,000 tons per annum, which is going to be like 4 lakh tons per annum by Q2 FY23. So that will support our further addition in value-added derivatives product. Total CapEx for this will be around 695 crore. Part of which we have spent in FY24 and part of which we are going to spend in FY22. And in terms of completion of the product, as you can see, epichlorohydrin, we have completed almost 60% of the expansion project completion, CPVC by 40% and caustic soda by 40%. So moving on in those lines, as we said, we are getting into the new products. So our main focus, again, as we had guided earlier, that our aspiration is to reach to the turnover of 2000 crore by FY24. So by all the blocks that we have already placed in terms of expansion will make us reach over there. So earlier also you can see in FY21, the derivative segment, which was contributing to the total revenue was 26%. By FY24, that will be contributing more than 50%. So in FY20, derivatives were contributing around 14%, which came up to 26%. And by FY24, we expect it to be more than 50%. Now, let us go to the financials. For that, let me invite Mr. Sanjay Jain, our CFO, who will take you through the financials. Sanjay.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. About financial, I would like to inform you that company believes in generating sustainable profit. Revenue from operation with an average CAGR of 21% in the last 4 years, company achieved the revenue from operation of 829 crore in FY21. For year-to-year comparison, the revenue from operation has increased from 611 crore in FY20 to 829 crore in FY21, thus almost increased by 36% year-on-year basis. This is mainly on account of high volumes of caustics and hydrogen peroxide. EBITDA margin. As you know that FY 2019 was an exceptional year for chloralkali industries. Company had made a high, ever highest EBITDA margin of 44%. Ignoring that, if you look at the EBITDA margin for FY 2021, company achieved an EBITDA margin of 261 crore against 194 crore in FY 20. Thus, it is almost increased by 35%. Though FY 2021 was a tough year, it's odd everywhere. In spite of that, company able to manage the EBITDA margin of 32%. Profit after tax in FY 21 has reduced to 101 crore compared to 112 crore in FY 2020. That is dropped by almost 10%. This is mainly on account of higher cost of interest and depreciation post commissioning of the expansion project, which company has took in last 2 to 3 years. Next. Apart from the key strength, strong balance sheet is also one of the key strengths of the company. As company has borrowed a term loan for funding its expansion project, the debt to EBITDA, which was high at 2.7% in FY 20, has improved to 2.1 in FY 2021, thus reflecting the healthy cash flows and improved margin. Even the return of capital employed, which was at 15% in FY 20, that has also improved to FY 16%. As company has heavily invested in the expansion projects, so company is very confident that return of capital employed will improve in near future. Company always focus on sustainable operations and maintain the highest standard of ESG. With respect to environment, company manages critical resources to minimize the wastage and maximize the yield. Company also believe in the principle of 3R, that is reuse of material, recycle of material, and reduce the waste. Make operation very efficiently. Company also believe in the 4R, that is renewable, as one of the company's upcoming project of ECS is first to be run on 100% renewable resources. Recently, company has been awarded a responsible care certification from ICC. Which reflect the high standard of health, safety, and environment which company has maintained. Company is also actively involved in the social activity. Company organized the medical camp. Company incurred a substantial amount in the under CSR program. During the pandemic, company distributed the ration kits in Bharuch and Ahmedabad district. Company organized the vaccination camp for its employee and its family members. Company also treat the employee with the dignity and respect to have the best for the organization. With respect to corporate governance is always a top priority for the company. Company believe in maintaining the high standard of disclosure and transparency with its stakeholder. And I think this meet is our step toward that. Over to Milind, thank you.
Okay, so what are the priorities for the company going forward? So we will be focusing on our strength, which is right now, that is a fully integrated facility. So we'll be working on that to optimize that and increase the efficiency improvements. Again, the cost, which was the priority of the company since very beginning. And again, we'll be focusing on that, and that can be improved because we are getting into the value-added products. So there will be economies of scale, which will help us to reduce our cost and improve the margins. Again, the growth. Like company has already set up plans. We have already put up the blocks in place for the future growth that is supposed to happen. But again, the growth will be not at the cost of the margins. So we'll be maintaining that. Now, let me introduce Mr. Ravi B, who is a strategic advisor to the Make Money Finechem Limited. He will take you through this slide.
Good afternoon, valued investors and analysts. Some of you would have probably interacted with me earlier. I was the CFO of Adani Ports. Here I'm advising them on the strategy and the investor relations. We have just showcased to you one of the best companies in the chemical industry, or can I say the dark horse in the chemical industry. It has emerged out of Make Money Organics Limited, and that's why we say it's an unlocking of the value through Make Money Finechem Limited. you have actually seen that in this company, you have everything that an investor would ask for. It's a high growth company. You can see that there's a 34% CAGR expected in the next 3-4 years. It is the highest EBITDA always maintained in the chemical industry. Even in the chlor-alkali, which is expected to be a commodity, the company has been doing an EBITDA of 30% and above, which is better than specialty chemicals EBITDA ever. It's a front runner in that industry, in this industry. Is also setting up an import substitution in ECH and CPVC, as you have just seen. It's the first time that such kind of a the products are coming into India. Till now, everything was being imported. With just about 700 crores of investments in the coming 1 year, what the investors are going to get is the benefit of the EPS increasing with no further investments of going up to 2000 crores of turnover. And with the kind of EBITDA margin, you can easily expect 600 crores and above as the EBITDA itself. So welcome, friends, to the jewel in the firmament of chemical industry. Thank you.
I'll ask Urbi to take it over.
So I guess anyone looking to ask a question can raise their hands, please. So I'll allow you them. Adarsh, can you unmute yourself? Do you want to ask a question? You have raised the hand. Adarsh Salaria. Yeah, Bhavin, unmute yourself and you can go ahead.
Thanks, Rakesh, and thanks presentation. Thanks to management for the excellent presentation and giving the roadmap ahead. Few questions. In the current business, how much do you sell directly chlorine in the open market, and how much you are converting into value-added product? And after your expansion, what would be that mix?
Currently, we are consuming around 40% of our chlorine, hydrogen and caustic soda internally or through pipeline our customers, and the remaining we are selling to the market. And down the line, as CPVC and ECH will be commissioned, so all are consuming hydrogen, caustic soda and chlorine together. So we are expanding also caustic soda. So after all our expansion, again, we will be end up with a 50% captive consumption and 50% will be in the selling in the market. So for the caustic soda and the chlorine and hydrogen, probably we will be around approximately around 65% will be captively and the remaining will be in the market.
Okay. And for each of your products, do you have a contractual relationship with the clients, and are there any short long-term contracts, or I know caustic is a commodity that is sold more on a monthly contracts in spot market, but for the other products, what are the relationship with the clients in nature of contracts and offtake?
You're talking about the caustic soda or derivatives?
No, derivatives.
Okay, derivatives business, mainly we are doing with chloromethane, where we have a bigger customer like Arvindo, Dr. Reddy. Those people, they are doing a quarterly contract with us. And a company like GFL and company like Naveen Fluorine, they are doing also a quarterly contract with us for the chloroform. So we have, you can say around 50%, we are doing a quarterly contract with a bigger customer. And for hydrogen peroxide, also the same thing. You know, bigger customer, like bigger paper mill, like ITC and other paper mill companies, they are doing a quarterly contract or the 6-monthly contract with us. But remaining, we are selling in the textile segment and other segments, we are in the open market based on the price. So that is open for all, you know. So it is, you can say around 50-50, you can say we are doing right now.
Customer service next to would you like to take that?
Yeah. So very big.
Sure. And are these high EBITDA margins sustainable? What kind of margins you expect when you reach 2,000 odd crores of turnover? Are the margin mix improving further?
So, you know, in our product basket, we are increasing along with the epichloroethylene product and the CPVC product. So both the products are very unique. First kind of manufacturing in India. So definitely we are going to continue the whatever the margin we are doing currently in chloroalkali as well as chloromethane and hydrogen peroxide. We are expecting much higher EBITDA probably in the future time because the epoxy market for the ECH is growing in double digit. And a lot of multinational companies are coming into the India for setting up their epoxy resin market to tap the Indian consumption as well as the Indian infrastructure. So we are expecting we will be able to maintain the margin definitely.
Sure. And the last one, what is the current net debt and peak net debt after your capex is over? And what is the current March 21 net worth of the company?
Yeah. So Sanjay, you can.
Look at the current debt as on 31st March 2021. The company has a debt of 464 crore as far as the long term is concerned. And down about 78 crore for the working capital. That is the total borrowing for FY21 in the balance sheet. Going forward in FY22 year ended, we may going to have term borrowing of around about 520 crore because we are going to borrow term loan for expansion project, that is ECH, which already been tied up with one of the institutions. Net worth as of now is around about 685 crores as on 31st March 2021.
Sure. And if you can highlight the shareholding pattern of this company and what's the listing update?
First. So, as I
have
mentioned, currently it will be. The current process of demergering will be over by mid of July. And in terms of shareholding pattern means promoters and the public. So in the promoters will be around 70% will be promoters and 30% will remain with the public in Make Money Fine Chemical Limited.
Okay, so there was earlier IFC which is exited, right? The promoters bought that stake, right?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Yeah.
Thank you.
Next, we have Rohit Nagraj. Rohit, can you unmute yourself?
Thanks for the opportunity. So, two questions. One is on the operations and another on the business. So, on CPVC front, I understand that a few years back, we had been talking to Mitsui for the same thing. So currently, who is the technology provider that we have tied up, and where we'll get the PVC resin from? Thank you.
Yeah, Rohit, it was a good question. You know, the Mitsui thing we were talking in the past, it was not materialized because of there was three party in the transactions and we are moving forward, and that time the market was not supporting the investment which we are targeting with the technology which we are going to bring. Over the period of time, the China has developed the CPVC resin technology, and we are coming with the Chinese technology for the CPVC, and our customers is going to be all the compound manufacturers and the pipe manufacturers who are manufacturing compound by themselves.
Right. My question was on the PVC resin. So yeah. Where we will source it?
Yeah. For PVC, you know, currently in India, is manufacturing capacity is around 1.5 million ton, and remaining 2.5 million ton is imported from other part of the world. So we will be having both the options, because as Reliance is next door, probably we'll keep the both the options as Reliance as well as the imported thing, you know.
Right. So do we have any firm commitments or initial talks with any of the, global players or with Reliance?
No, we have already discussed with a couple of players. But, you know, as our plant will be commissioned, before 3 months, we are going to conclude that discussion. But we have already discussed before we finalize the technology with our PVC suppliers.
Right. Thanks a lot for that. The second question is on the operations front. Unfortunately, we have seen, in last few years that every after 2-3 years, we have had some or the other accidents, right from 2013, 16, and latest being in 19. So to arrest this particular aspect of safety, what are the steps that the management has taken in the last few years? Thank you so much.
Rohit, if you see Makemari Fine Chemical, there is not such kind of incident happened in the past. It has very clear history from the beginning.
Right, but it was the erstwhile group when the Makemari Fine Chem was also part of Makemari Organics. Probably just to take cues from our earlier. Parent company, anything that we have done so that such incidents don't occur in future?
Yeah, so see, Makemari Fine Chemical Limited, it was from the beginning, it was private equity partner are there. So based on their guidance, we have implemented all the systems taken into the in the company, and along with the HSC, we have required, in today's in India, best standard is a responsible care certificate also we have received in last quarter. So, we are doing all the best practices which is available, best standards available in the industry right now in Makemari Fine Chemical Limited. And from the beginning, since 2007, there was no such kind of incident or record in the history of Makemari Fine Chemical Limited.
Thank you so much and best of luck.
Thank you.
Thank you, Rohit. Rajesh, can you unmute yourself and go ahead with your question? Also, can you please introduce yourself, Rajesh?
Hello.
Yeah, go ahead, Rajesh.
See, my short question is, you have indicated a total capex of 695 crores. A certain amount you have indicated that it will be spent in FY22. Some of the amount you have indicated has been spent in FY21. So what was the amount which has been spent earlier, or any spillover will be there for FY23?
For the capex of 695 crore for company expansion, if you look at the presentation, we already see that company has incurred 134 crore till FY2021. And for the coming year, that is FY22, company is planning to have another 350 crore of expenditure for this plan. And just will be placed in FY2023. That is first half of FY23.
The project is expected to commence in the first quarter. So just before the commencement of the project, the rest of the capital expenditure would be done. So that would be the small spillover into FY23.
Okay. Thank you.
Hitesh, can you ask your question and unmute yourself?
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity and the detailed presentation. So could you just help us understand, or probably what gives you the confidence that, our products, both ECH and CPVC, will find good acceptance and will be able to compete well with the global players who have been exporting to our country?
Hitesh, you know, it was a nice question. You know, I just wanted to currently the India is importing 70% of the ECH from the Thailand.
Right.
And the Thailand, the same technology who has supplied to Thailand plant and setting up the Thailand plant, we are bringing the same technology. So we are assured that the 70% who are using our customers in India, we are bringing the same technology in India. So there is no doubt in the future in terms of ECH and in terms of CPVC, you know, before anti-dumping came into India about CPVC resin, you know, China has exported a quite big amount of CPVC resin in India and Indian customer has used it. So based on that, we have taken a call that we can continue with that technology from China for the CPVC. So we are comfortable and our customer has used in the past and based on their feedback, we have gone ahead and finalized this technology.
Sure, thanks. On the ECH, I believe the company which has been importing to the country is Advanced Biochemical. And if I look at their margin profile, it's just been about 20-22% has been the margin profile. And I believe they are also well integrated as us. And I believe what the margin that we are guiding for is north of 30%. So just wanted to understand anything different in our cost structure vis-a-vis this player who has been importing to country.
That's a nice question. You know, normally the overhead cost, manufacturing cost, the raw material, but other part of the cost of the project is very high in Thailand compared to India. So that's why we are as a, you know, after China, people consider as a second manufacturing hub of Asia. So definitely we have a better edge in terms of manufacturing costs, in terms of other overhead costs, in terms of manpower costs. So definitely our EBITDA margin will be much higher than the what they are in they are getting in Thailand.
Okay, sure. And if you mind naming this Chinese company from where we are sourcing this CPVC technology from?
No, that it is confidential. We can't disclose that.
Sure. Just the last thing, what would be our peak debt by the time we complete our expansion?
Around over 700 crores.
Let's, Hitesh, let me put it in a better, in a number which will be better understood. Even after the, you know, the new expansion, even after taking that 520 crores of debt, what Sanjay said, because of the high profitability and the net worth, as well as good EBITDA, that debt EBITDA ratios will continue to be around 2.1 or 2.5, which is extremely comfortable. Maybe, you know, if you put it in that perspective, I think it will be best understood. In terms of numbers, yeah, it could be in the range of 700 to 800 crores.
Including working capital.
Yeah, including working capital.
Sure. Thank you.
Thank you, Hitesh. Mr. Ramesh Maheshwari, can you ask your question? Unmute yourself.
Yeah, good evening and thank you very much for giving this opportunity. Myself, Ramesh Maheshwari, I have two questions. One is the what will be the export and domestic content once the projects are over? And the second question is that how you are safeguarding, as a lot of people are talking nowadays that specialty chemicals are peaked out. And the third question is, as the huge competition is in caustic soda market, how you are going to take over, take care of that?
So,
hello. Am I clear or?
Yeah, it is very clear. Ramesh, you know, regarding the export and import, you know, currently we are doing around 5 to 10% in the existing product line. We are doing export, but in the future, definitely we will have an export opportunity in terms of epichlorohydrin in the product basket. Because this is completely import substitute, so we are targeting more on the duty paid material arrived in India from other part of the world. So we are getting more realization from India. So our target will be more, you know, more focused towards India always. If, you know, because our target is not based on the export and import, it is based on the realization what we have maximum. So definitely so far, based on our experience on the derivatives, chloromethane, we are getting maximum realization from the domestic market. So we are not doing any export possibility, or we are not trying for any exports. But definitely there is an opportunity for epichlorohydrin business in the future for the export. Second, your question about the caustic soda. You know, caustic soda, you are absolutely right that in the beginning of Make Money Fine Chemical Limited, we were only chloroalkali player and we are dependent highly on the caustic soda market and the business. But down the line in last 3 years, you know, we have started focusing on the value addition more, and in the future also we are going to focus more on the value addition. So our diversifying in terms of product basket as well as de-risk by ourselves by product portfolio, we are going to be not dependent on the caustic soda business only in the future. Second, caustic soda business also, if you see our past history, we have a, even if it is known as a commodity, but we have a high EBITDA margin, we have achieved. You can see in our presentation. So we don't consider caustic soda as a commodity, or it is a low margin business. And compared to our peers, we have a highest profitability for the caustic soda business. So caustic soda business is also, it is equally important for us in coming in down the line.
Okay. The third one is, I asked about specialty chemicals, as the people are projecting that there will be this has peaked out. So any answers, are you taking care of that part also?
See, I, as a Make Money Fine Chemical, we feel that, it is not a peaked out, because this is just a beginning in India. Because in Indian consumption, Indian expansion, infrastructure, the spending economy, everything is growing in India. So all these epoxy resin or CPVC that are growing in double digit. So this is just a beginning. But other specialty chemicals which you are talking about for the export purpose right now, if you are asking for the general market, we consider ourselves as a second hub of manufacturing after China. So people are looking for a second alternative. So there is a future growth and opportunity will continue in India.
Okay, thank you very much. But I feel that all your expansion plans will bring fortunes to the shareholders like us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ramesh. Mr. Karthik Sampadhan, can you please unmute yourself and ask a question?
Hello, hi. Thank you for taking my question. Am I audible?
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah. So to understand the mental map with all the demand and supply, right? So bear with me if I, ask you question regarding each component. So when it comes to caustic, right? So what's the demand and supply in FY21 and FY24?
You're asking for caustic soda market in
yes. 21, and what do you project at 24? Where will it be?
Yeah, Karthik, normally in the caustic soda business, people consider that your economy is growing, that much growth is there in the caustic soda business. Because caustic soda is such a business where it is used by all the industries, starting from alumina. So people not in a country like growing like India, the alumina plant is expanding, like Aditya Alumina is expanding, another private company is expanding on the eastern part, and all the chemicals, it is like a potatoes of all the chemical industries, so all the businesses are growing. Caustic soda demand will grow, and every year India requires now one chloroalkali plant of approximately is around 150,000 tons plant every year. So we are still far below our capacity in terms of caustic soda. I feel the way growth is started in India in terms of infrastructure, I feel there is a huge difference right now in India and China. China has grown last 20 years, and there is a huge difference between Indian capacity and Chinese capacity, almost 10 times. So as country will grow, definitely the caustic soda demand will grow and the demand will continue. but to be very specific answer in terms of quantity, I don't have for 2024.
Okay, so but you know, when we look into the capacity that's coming in by even our peer groups and different players, right? So everyone's sort of expanding by FY24. So there is a lot of supply that's coming into the system. So that's why I was asking, and we know that you know, caustic prices shot up at FY19 to almost double of what it was now, and that's helped most of the caustic players' margin. But now that it's almost touched 7-year low and it's sort of coming back thanks to the demand. I was just curious, you know, with a lot of supply now coming in, will it be in the same range or what is your projections on it?
So, see, caustic soda, we are facing that we feel that it is going to continue increase from now onwards because there is no new plants are coming up in 1 year time at least. And many chemicals expansions, you know, pharmaceutical expansions, agrochemical expansions are going on right now. So definitely everybody will consume caustic soda. So down the line, it will absorb the capacity which will come in next year.
See, Karthik, just want to add a few important information which is a driving for the caustic industry. If India wants to grow at a GDP of 7-8% year on year, then definitely one caustic plant is minimum requirement. If you look at the history of China, from the population point of view, India and China both are practically similar population, right? And China is adding practically every year one India's caustic capacity, 4 million ton year on year from last maybe 15 to 20 years. So India is far away from that. Now, if the Prime Minister Modi has a vision to make a 5 trillion economy, then chemical sector will play a huge role to achieve that. And to achieve 5 trillion economy in chemical sector, cost without caustic, it's not possible because it's a basic building block. What is most essential for the chloralkali industry is to have a downstream. That's what we have. And that's that. The way we had diversified the complex from caustic potash to chloromethanes to hydrogen peroxide. So we are not only having a caustic as a major product, but also the downstream. And if in the presentation, if you have seen, you know, that our weightage will be 50% to the caustic industry, 50% to the downstream. So it's a mixed basket. And the way the specialty chemical industry investment is confirmed, committed in last 1 year and henceforth without caustic soda or chlorine or hydrogen, that growth will not be sustainable because this is a basic building block. So if you want to make a dairy products, you require a milk. Same way, if you want to make chemicals, you require chloralkali industry.
So in fact, That's very good insight because, you know, that was my next question. You know, we have made the right move going to the next derivative that's coming in, right? So for that, I wanted to understand ECH, you said the current market size is 69 kilotons per annum. Is that right?
Yeah.
And we are coming up with a 50. I'm guess one of our peers are also probably coming up with a 50, another plant. So how do you think the projection of demand will be in FY23-24 for that?
So Karthik, in Corona year, you know, we have achieved 65,000 KTA for the epichlorohydrin import. But normal year, I think we will cross definitely 75,000 tons. Okay. So current demand, if you consider in a full year basis, is 75,000 tons in a year. And it is growing at double digit right now in India. And looking at, you know, the expansion announced by the epoxy resin manufacturers, we feel that down the line 2 years, you know, the demand of ECH will require minimum more than 120 KTA in India.
Okay.
We don't find if anybody will come because India is a unique country. So far, there was no manufacturer. That's why we consider, you know, there was an issue if somebody else will come. But at the same time, the growth is also the epoxy resin market is also growing in India.
Got it. So that's why I wanted to know what's your prediction probably. I think 125, 130 is a decent number. And similarly for hydrogen peroxide, right? Could you probably quantify the market now and FY24?
See, hydrogen peroxide, the major market for hydrogen peroxide is textile, paper, and chemical industries. So all three industries are growing right now. Definitely textile is growing and the chemical industries, the application of hydrogen peroxide as a raw material or as a environmental treatment system, it is growing in India. So as down the line, the chloroalkali, not chemical industries will come in India, definitely the consumption of hydrogen peroxide will also grow. Currently, the people have two different manufacturing capacity in India. Some people have a backward integration of chloroalkali and some people they don't have. So we feel that the people who don't have a, you know, complete backward integration, we may face problem in the coming times, because you know it is not a cost effective solutions for the hydrogen peroxide.
Understood. What's the market size currently, sir, for hydrogen peroxide?
See, frankly speaking, you know, the, we feel that the currently market size is around 350 KTA, but we feel that in the corona situation, sometimes textile is down, sometimes paper is down, so it is very difficult to predict completely in a full year basis. But you can say around 350 KTA is the current market size of India.
Sure. And I'm guessing the demand was quite low this year. That's the reason the utilization was around 50 to 60.
No, you're talking about our productivity?
Yeah, the productivity in hydrogen peroxide.
Yeah, because, you know, this is the first year for hydrogen peroxide when we started. So it is a process of achieving the full capacity. Normally it takes 1 year time. The chemist, because of the process is such that, you know, it is taking 1 year time. So it is not nothing to do with our capacity or somebody else's capacity, or it is because of the technical reason we have to grow, we have to go gradually increase our capacity to reach on a full capacity. So by July end, we will reach our full capacity for hydrogen peroxide.
That's great. And what's the margins that we notice in hydrogen peroxide, sir?
See, definitely, you know, we would not like to comment on the individual product margin, but definitely we are targeting always high beta product, which generate high beta, and high beta it is. So it is in line with what we have our results. You know, we do not want to disclose, frankly speaking, you know, individual product beta.
That's fine, sir. Thank you. Thank you for taking my question.
Thank
All
you.
The best.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Karthik. Mr. Deepak, can you unmute yourself and ask the question?
Am I audible?
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, thank you very much for taking my question. Sir, I have two questions. First, can you just throw some light on the gross margins on your base chloroalkali product versus the derivative products like CPVC, chloromethane, or hydrogen peroxide? And my second query is this incremental 695 crores capex. So what would be the incremental depreciation that will come along with it? Yeah, that's it. Thank you.
The second question.
Yeah, Deepak, about the gross margin for the company, including all the products in the basket, we maintain the gross margin about 55%. As of now. And the individual, as Maulik Bhai said, that we don't want to disclose individually, but 50-55% is the gross margin as of now in last 2 years, in spite of pandemic year.
Mm-hmm. So would it be possible to share between the base product and the derivative product? So how is the difference in terms of gross margin?
At the, you know, breakup of revenue in FY21, we have revenue of 25% from the derivative side and 75% from the chloroalkali side.
Mm-hmm.
So you can.
Okay, understand. And regarding depreciation.
Sorry, he asked the second question was about the capital expenditure of 695 crores. What would be the depreciation? Is that the question?
Yeah, the incremental depreciation.
It is the 695 crore being a continuous plant, we are going to have a, you know, average life of 12 to 15 years over there. So based on that, our depreciation, high depreciation, once the plant going to be, you know, commissioned, all the plant commissioned, it may be in the range of 93 to 100 crores. Including existing.
Yeah.
Including existing. I understood. Thank you. That's it from me.
30 crores.
30 crores will be additional.
Yeah, yeah, understood. Thank you.
Thanks, Deepak. Mr. Swarnabh Mukherjee, can you please unmute yourself and ask a question?
Hello, Mr. Mukherjee, am I audible?
Yeah, yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for the opportunity. Two, three questions from my side. So first of all, in the from the existing capacity, can you give me a color on, you know, how much more revenue potential is available? Because I can see that in and around you have 80% from your existing products utilization is running, and H2O2 I think is ramping up. So how much more total revenue can come from this?
You know, I think it is a good question, because hydrogen peroxide we have not achieved full capacity. Even chloroalkali expansion, what we did last year and capitalize it, that is also we have not achieved a full year basis because of Corona. So this year definitely we are expecting another 35% growth on the top line, and probably we will reach 1200 crore revenue this financial year.
And that is the max that we can get from the current capacity, right? I mean, broadly considering standard prices.
Yes, based on the current prevailing market prices. Yes.
Yeah, yeah. Of course, I do understand that the revenue is a function of the product prices. So, yeah, all right. And also, sir, on the new capex that is coming up, 659 crores, would it entirely be growth capex, or some infrastructure investment would also be there?
I think it's a very good question, you know, you asked, you know, because majority of capex on the infrastructure we needed in last 10 years. So now in a small capex, we are adding a product and we are getting high advantage in terms of revenue, in terms of EBITDA. So there was no infrastructure capex is required till we achieve 2000 crore. So all the infrastructure we have required for the 2000 crore, we needed in our last capex cycle.
Okay, okay, sir. And how much time will you take post commissioning to fully consume the new capacity?
So, you know, in ECH, we are targeting to achieve full capacity in within 4 to 6 month time, and in CPVC, we are targeting to achieve full capacity by 6 month time.
Okay, sir. Right. That's very helpful. And last question, sir, if you could highlight, you know, the factors that help you to achieve best-in-class margins. I mean, is it a factor of scale, automation? What would be the key drivers for that?
Key drivers for the EBITDA margin, you can say we are very well integrated. Complex, we have the way we do a management on the campus is we don't have a compartmental, like, you know, with many complex people have a compartmental kind of culture. So we do not have that kind of culture in our premises. Second, the minimum wastage we have, and the majority of the customers, but the 30 to 40% customers are consuming chlorine and hydrogen by pipeline down the line. So, you know, efficiency, you can achieve more when you have customers next door to you. And we are right sitting in the chemical hub of India. So all the customers are located within 300 kilometers or 400 kilometers. All the raw materials, we are next to the port area. So even raw materials, we are getting it in within 5 kilometers. Salt is a major raw material. We are getting it in 50 kilometers. So all those advantages bring us so there are so many factors. You can't say only one factor which can bring the high beta. And definitely you can also, I know, we would like to credit as a promoters, you know, all our promoters are technocrats. So that in terms of selection of the technology, in terms of efficiency achievement, you know, we focus too much in terms of recirculation of the water. So every cost and penny we try to save, And you know, when there is no end, we continuously target to achieve more and more every year.
Right, sir. Got it. Got it. Thank you for the detailed answer and all the best, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mukherjee. Mr. Indrayan, can you please unmute yourself and ask question?
Yeah, sure. Thanks for the opportunity. I have a couple of questions specifically on the ECH chemical. You did mention earlier that there are not many manufacturers in the ECH chemical category in India. Can you tell me what the reason is? Is it a difficult chemical to manufacture? And if the market is growing at 30%, why haven't there been many manufacturers before?
Can you repeat your question?
Why nobody manufactured ECH till now? Is it so difficult to manufacture that you're the only first one? Why did the others not come in?
I think it's a good question, because in 2010, we have thought about this product. But that time, the Indian consumption was very less. And economy of size of the plant, after spending technology and everything, was not feasible enough to get high EBITDA. So we postpone it till India reach at the right capacity and growth. So now we feel that India has reached to 70,000, 80,000 ton capacity in India. So one plant can easily absorb in India. So we are coming with this plant.
And adding to what Maulik has said, back in 2010, the technology was very much different than what is available now. It's more mature, more advanced, and based on the renewable technology. So as we are focusing on more and more on ESG and having a responsible care, it becomes our very important responsibility to invest in such technology. So that was another driving force to go for ECH now.
Okay, got it. And can you just describe a bit about the end market for ECH and why is it growing at 30% CAGR? What is driving the demand for this chemical?
Yeah, not 30%, but definitely next 2 years we are expecting, because the epoxy resin is a major market. So epoxy resin goes into the infrastructure for adhesive, for tiles. The biggest usage is automobile industries. The third biggest is the paint industries. So all this segment is growing in India, and windmill is growing as a renewable, because windmill, the blade is required epoxy paint, which is also a major consumption. Second, all the chemical tanks, sometimes they require epoxy coating. So all this, the capex momentum in India, the consumption right now is growing, automobile industries is growing, infrastructure is growing. Because of that, we feel it is the right time in India, and the growth is very high in India.
Got it. And
so that is the major reason for growth. And so see, when some multinational coming into the India to manufacture epoxy resin, world biggest manufacturer, they decided to come in India. So they must have a lot of calculations before they enter in India. So big manufacturers are also coming into the India, which is next door to our plant, which is almost 5 kilometers. So all these signs are in a high growth of epoxy resin in coming time.
Got it. And amongst all the products, like post all the capex has happened over the next 3 years, would ECH and CPVC be the highest realization products in our portfolio?
So, we cannot comment on the profitability of the overall company, but whatever the target, what we have kept for around 30% EBITDA, more than 30% EBITDA, we would like to continue this even if we reach to 2000 crore. That is our target even after commissioning of ECH and CPVC, you can say that. Yeah.
Right. And ECH would be commissioned in FY23, I assume. And when would that reach full capacity in your assumption?
So ECH, quarter two next year, next financial year, the ECH will be reached to full capacity, and the CPVC definitely will be the end of third quarter. It will reach to around 80% capacity.
Okay, got it. Thanks. That's it for now.
Thanks, Indrayan. Mr. Mohit Mehta, if you can unmute yourself and ask a question.
Thanks a lot for giving an opportunity.
I just had one question with respect to the CPVC segment.
Your voice is very low. Can you just speak it louder?
Hello?
Yeah, now it's very
loud. Yeah, so I just had a question regarding the CPVC segment. I just want to understand what the market size is and what the competitive landscape looks like, because very recently there was an announcement from Grasim, which is that they are also coming up with a pretty big capacity, particularly for CPVC. So I just wanted to understand the overall market size and how we are placed.
You know, Mohit, it is a very good question, because, you know, people who are in the CPVC regime and in the pipe market, only those people will understand more about this question. Because when somebody says that they are coming into the CPVC business, so Lubrizol is coming with the CPVC resin plant only for the captive purpose for the Lubrizol with Grasim. So their customer is only single customer, Lubrizol. And like for Make Money, we are coming with the CPVC resin for the people who are manufacturing compound by themselves, like 100 people, like Astral, like Prince, like Phenolex, like so many people, you know. So we are targeting more than 100 people who are manufacturing compound by themselves and the pipe by themselves. Those are our customers. And Grasim is coming with the Lubrizol only for the Lubrizol supply, and Lubrizol will make themselves by their compound and they will supply to their customers. So both business models are different.
Understood. That's great insight into the business as well. Thanks a lot. All the best for the future.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mohit. Mr. Levin Shah, if you can unmute yourself and ask a question.
Yeah. Thanks a lot, sir, for the opportunity. My first question is on this ECH business. So we are doing a capex of around 270 crores. So if you can give some sense about what are the kind of asset turns that are possible over here.
Are you asking about asset turnover?
Yeah, asset turnover for ECH business.
It is 450 crore for ECH. So it is around
about
1 to 1.75.
Okay, so at full capacity utilization of 50,000 tons, we would do around 450 crores kind of revenue. Right. Sir, and my other question is on this. I missed it when you had addressed it to an earlier participant. The in-house consumption of this chlorine, currently you said is like around 40%, and what this will go to once we are through with all our expansions?
Levin, you know, if you see, we are expanding our chloroalkali along with our chlorine downstream. So in terms of percentage, may not increase in the future, but in terms of quantity, definitely we are going to consume in-house chlorine in the CPVC as well as in ECH, epichlorohydrin.
Okay. So, sir,
in terms of percentage, it will remain same, 40 to 50%, you know, we are going to consume captively or by pipeline.
Okay, okay. Sir, and another question is on this capex. So, like what we have mentioned in our presentation as well, totally we are going to spend around 695 crores and 134 crores out of that is spent in FY21. So, balance 350 crores in FY22 and the rest would be in FY23, right?
Yeah.
Right. Okay, sir. So the peak debt that we would be requiring maybe in the current year, that is FY22, would be like around 700 crores, or there is a possibility that we might go further above, slightly above that as well?
No, actually, we have already answered, like, peak debt maybe around 720 crores. That is the thing. Taking care of all these expansion projects.
See, Levin, there is a repayment also happening of the old loans, and the new loan coming in and the old loan being repaid, the peak debt still would not be above 720, 800 crores maximum. And with that, because of the debt, because of the EBITDA margins being high, the debt EBITDA ratio will be in the vicinity of 2.1 to 2.5 only.
Okay, okay. Sir, and one just last thing. What was the cash flow generation for FY21?
It is up to 175 crores.
After working capital.
Yeah.
sorry. So just a clarification. This is after working capital, right?
No, this is only from the operation 175 crores.
Yeah. Okay. So what that number would be after working capital investments?
There was hardly any working capital required.
Working capital is actually company is already working on, you know, with the optimized level of working capital, so there is no much change as far as working capital change in working capital is concerned. So it is in the range of about 200 crores, not more than that.
Okay. Okay. Got it, sir. Thank you and all the best.
Thank you.
Thanks, Levin. Mr. Hiten Boricha, can you please unmute yourself and ask questions?
Hello.
Yeah, go ahead, Mr. Hiten.
Thanks for the opportunity, sir. So I have just two clarification questions. The first question is, you mentioned our ECH and CPVC capacity will start by end of this year, FY22. Am I correct, sir?
ECH, we are going to start by end of this financial year, and by end of quarter one next financial year, we are going to start CPVC.
Okay. Thanks for the clarification. And the second question is on the debt. You mentioned our debt will go up to, peak debt will go up to 700 crore in FY22 itself, right?
Yes.
Okay. And can you provide what is the cost of borrowing, sir? The current cost of borrowing?
About 7%.
7%, right? Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. That's all from my side. Yeah.
Thanks, Hiten. We have two questions on the chat box. So Mr. Sanjay Ghosh is asking, post the 700 crore capex, what can be our peak revenue assuming 100% capacity utilization?
What would be the peak what?
Revenue.
Peak revenues assuming 100% capacity utilization.
See, we have by full year operation, definitely the ECH will start, part of ECH and the revenue will start from next year onwards. CPVC also will start from next year onwards. So financial year 2024, we have considered on the full year basis with an 80% capacity of the ECH and CPVC. We will achieve 2000 crore. That is our target we have kept it.
Anybody else having any questions, can please raise the hand.
The listing date.
There's Neeraj is asking, what is the listing date for both the companies?
Yeah, so both the, we are going to on the final submission of the application of BSE NSE, and probably it will be done on Monday or Tuesday, and it will be listed by mid of July.
Early July. Okay. Levin Shah is asking, what is the total outstanding number of shares for MFL?
Yeah, total number of shares is down to 4.90 lakhs pursuant to the scheme of arrangement. So it's 4.90, and share holding pattern will be around 70% with the promoters and 30% with the public, going to be with the public.
Mr. Narup consultant is asking, if he has to analyze MFL historicals, will the standalone financials of MFL will be relevant post demerger, or what has to look at?
Sorry, didn't get the question.
Can you repeat it?
So he's asking that whether the standalone financials of MFL are the relevant numbers he has to look at for historical.
Yes,
that's
right.
We
already
audited these
numbers in FF for FF21, which I think Milan, you already shared.
No, he is talking about the past years. Yes. MFL has always been maintained as a separate company and having a completely separate balance sheet only for consolidation issues to come. So any analysis of MFL can be done out of the previous audited numbers which are there, available in the standalone numbers of MFL.
And the company already has the annual reports of last 5 years on its website, so people can have access to that also.
Okay. Yeah. So the question is, same goes for MOL as well. on a standalone basis, can I look at MOL? Would that be relevant as of now as well, post demerger?
Yes, of course.
MOL has always given standalone and consolidated numbers. So whatever information you see on public domain, those are MOL numbers, and yes, these are definitely relevant.
Okay, so the business of the subsidiary of MFL, it is only getting the demerged from MOL. Yeah,
that's right.
Okay,
that's right.
So no other business of MOL is being going with MFL.
No.
Okay. Got it. Yeah, thank you.
So Hiten is asking whether we have CapEx breakup of CPVC and ECH.
We have already given.
It's already in the presentation.
No. Total capex.
No.
250 crores of.
275 crores for ECH and yes. Down to 190 crores for CPVC.
Yes.
Karna is asking if there is any separate presentation for FindCam investors with financials and future plans. So yes, Karna, it is there on company's website. You can have a look. Neeraj is asking, how are you planning to expense for shared infrastructure? If there are any like corporate office, etc.
There is no shared infrastructure
between the MOL and MFL. It's both independent, even at the facility, even at the corporate house.
Anybody else have any questions? Otherwise, we'll call it a day. Let's wait for 1 minute. Anybody else who wants to ask question? Please unmute yourself. So I think we are done. So thank you, everyone. Mr. Malik, would you like to make the closing comments before we close the session?
Thank you very much. I'd like to thank everyone to join this call. By showcasing MFL, we want to convey that commodity chemical producer can have the flavor of specialty chemicals also. We have invested heavily in CMS H2 to various derivatives in the last 3 years. And now those numbers will reflect in coming quarters. And to make India 3 million, as I said earlier also, to make India 5 trillion economy, chemical sector will play a vital role. And within chemical sector, chemical fluoroalkali and its derivatives are the founding pillars. We are committed towards our expansion. We are committed towards our deadlines. And as we are entering capital market, we are also focused toward achieving our numbers. At every step, management is taking the full responsibility of the corporate governance and environment. And our team is at your disposal for future interaction. And once again, thank you very much. And have a safe and healthy weekend. Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you, everyone. With this, we'll close.